Check it out now, y'all.
nanoHUB-U, online instruction.
Hello and welcome to nanoHUB-U's Introduction to Bioelectricity. This is week one in our fourth lecture, in which we will be discussing the resting potential of neuron membranes and how those resting potentials come about. And before we dive into the math, which will be lecture five, I want to talk about an intuitive understanding of what resting membrane potentials are, why they matter, why they come about, and almost as importantly, those factors that are not important in creating a resting membrane potential. So a neuronal membrane is like a skin between the outside of the cell and the inside of the cell. That skin is made of a phospholipid bilayer. And what you need to know for the purposes of this course is that it serves to isolate the environment inside the cell from the environment outside the cell. So you can have ions and neurotransmitters and structures inside the cell which will not interact with the outside of the cell unless they're allowed to do so. And the way that you allow that interaction between the inside of the cell and the outside of the cell is with something called an ion channel. Now, we'll talk about ion channels in greater depth in the third lecture of week two. But for now, let's talk about ion channels in two broad categories. There's ion transporters, which are a type of channel which actively select a particular type of ion and move it to the inside of the cell or to the outside of the cell. And then there's passive ion channels, which either open or close. They act like a door, but they don't move anything. You can think of ion transporters as a revolving door and ion channels as just a conventional door. So with the ion channel, there's one more layer of complexity in that an ion channel can be a door that opens and allows any kind of ion to flow through it, or it can be a door that only allows a specific type of ion. So it can be selective or non-selective. If it's selective, then, for example, if it's selective to potassium, then when it's open, only potassium ions can flow through it, and when it's closed, nothing flows through it. If it's not selective, then when it's open, potassium ions, sodium ions, calcium ions, all sorts of different ions present either outside or inside the cell can flow through it. And then it can also be partially selective, where, for example, when it's open, it might allow sodium or potassium ions to flow through it, but not calcium or other types of ions. So the selectivity varies from selective to non-selective and everything in between for these ion channels. With the ion transporters, those are selective and they establish very specific concentration gradients, and we'll get to that in a little bit. So when we're talking about the resting membrane potential, what are we referring to? If you take a neuron, any neuron in the body, and you measure the voltage of the inside of the cell with respect to the outside of the cell, you'll find that the inside is more negative electrically than the outside. In fact, for an average neuron, you're going to get an inside-to-outside membrane voltage of about negative 65 millivolts. So you measure anywhere along the neuron, and that's the resting membrane potential. So we talked in the last lecture about these base firing rates. So a neuron will be firing at a particular rate of so many action potentials per second. And then when you excite it, it fires more. And when you inhibit it, it fires less. Well, the same thing happens with a membrane voltage, except here we're not talking about frequency coding with more firings per second. We're talking about amplitude encoding. So you have a resting membrane potential, and when you hyperpolarize it, you make it more negative. When you depolarize it, you make it less negative. And what matters is the amplitude of that hyperpolarization or the depolarization. But you can only have those if you know what the starting resting membrane potential is. And so there is one. It's minus 65 millivolts. And today we're going to understand why there is one and how that comes about. So what are the conditions for the resting membrane potential? There are two. The first thing you need to establish a resting membrane potential is a concentration gradient. And what that means is that you have a concentration of a particular ion inside the cell and a concentration of that same ion outside the cell. And those concentrations are different. So you have a gradient. You have a slope going from a higher concentration to a lower concentration that dictates where those ions would flow if they were allowed to do so. Of course, you've got this membrane in the middle that doesn't let them flow, okay? But the first condition is you have to have that concentration gradient. The second condition is that you have to let some of those ions flow. So you have to create what's called a semi-permeable membrane. And that means that some ion channels will be open, and those ion channels that are open are going to be selectively permeable to only one or two types of ions, but in the cases we're going to talk about today, only one. So if you have a membrane and you have a concentration gradient and you have ion channels that are selectively permeable to those ions that are in that concentration gradient, you will get a resting membrane potential. Before we get to how, let's talk about the role of active transporters. So we talked at the beginning about how there's active transporters and there's passive ion channels, right? What's the role of active transporters in generating the resting membrane potential? And this is probably the single area of greatest confusion in understanding intuitively what's going on here. The role is absolutely none. Active transporters play absolutely no role in creating the resting membrane potential. They're important, but not in creating the membrane potential specifically. What they do is they establish the concentration gradient. So we need two things, right? We need this concentration gradient and we need the semipermeable membrane. The active transporters, they move the ions back and forth so that you'll have more potassium ions inside the cell than outside, and you'll have more sodium ions outside the cell than inside, and those are two concentration gradients that we have. And the active transporters create those concentration gradients. But having created those gradients, they don't do anything else. They create them and they maintain those gradients, but they don't create the resting membrane potential. That happens entirely passively. And that's extremely important. It's important because the active transporters, as you can imagine, being active, require a lot of energy. Passive processes require no energy because that's what passive means. If it required energy to maintain a resting membrane potential, which is something that every single neuron, remember there's 100 billion in your brain, and every single muscle fiber, for that matter, has in your body, then you would be consuming an enormous amount of energy just sitting around doing nothing. So the body has evolved a mechanism for creating these resting membrane potentials that requires no energy. And so the active ion transporters are out of the picture. They create the concentration gradient, and then that's it. So let's say initially that we have no concentration gradient. Let's say we have a membrane and we can put it in a box and isolate it from the world to study it. We have a membrane and you have some ions inside and some ions outside. Doesn't matter what the kind of ions are. Let's say that the ion concentration, the membrane is permeable to those ions and the concentration is the same on both sides. Well, what's going to happen? Nothing's going to happen. Once in a while, an ion will float through the membrane and then will float back. But on average, the concentration will stay the same. And because your net charge on both sides of the membrane is zero, the membrane voltage will remain zero. But in fact, we have a concentration gradient, and we can measure what that gradient is. And we have that gradient for a number of different ions that we're interested in squids and in people. Now, the most important ions are potassium ions and sodium ions. Calcium and chloride will come into the picture later in week two. But for today, potassium and sodium are the only ones you need to worry about. And so you have a measurable gradient of potassium and sodium in both squids and in people. And the squids are important because all of the original experiments that were done to understand everything we're talking about here were done on the giant squid axon. And we'll talk more about that in week four when we talk about Hodgkin and Huxley. But for now, we have this gradient where we have more potassium inside the cell than outside, and we have more sodium outside the cell than inside. So given that concentration gradient, what happens if the membrane is closed off and it's not permeable? Well, if it's not permeable, then neither ion can flow through it and nothing happens, right? Because there's no flow. So you have a net charge of zero inside because every potassium, excess potassium ion is counterbalanced by a negative anion. And you have a net charge on the outside of the cell because every excess sodium ion is similarly balanced by a negative anion. But if we make the membrane semi-permeable, semi-permeable specifically to potassium and not to sodium, and we maintain that concentration gradient, then what will happen? Over time, the potassium ions inside the cell will see that there is a higher concentration inside than outside and will diffuse out of the membrane. So any ion in a medium where it can move freely will disperse, will diffuse, so that the density of that ion is even throughout the medium. So if you have a high concentration inside the cell and you open the doors and there's a low concentration out, those ions will begin to flow out. And those ions are positively charged. So as the positive charge inside the cell leaves the cell, the voltage inside the cell will begin to drop. And the voltage outside the cell will begin to rise. Now the net voltage inside and outside will remain zero. But if you look right at the membrane, right at the interface of this neuronal membrane, you'll find that now you have some negative anions that used to counteract the potassium ions that have left, that have been left behind and they are uncoupled. You have some potassium ions that have flowed through the membrane and now they're outside the cell that are overwhelming the number of anions that exist outside the cell. So locally, you have a positive layer of charge on the outside of the cell, and you have a negative layer of charge on the inside of the cell. And that'll continue to happen until a different effect takes over. So as these potassium ions come out of the cell, the voltage inside will continue to drop, and the voltage outside will continue to rise until you get to a voltage of about minus 58 millivolts, minus 65 millivolts. It depends on the neuron and the conditions and the temperature and a number of different factors. But you'll get to some resting voltage. And why is that the resting voltage? Because at that voltage, the positively charged potassium ions outside of the cell will want to return because they will be attracted by the electric field. So there'll be two forces acting on these ions. They will be the diffusion force, making them want to continue to leave the cell because there's a higher concentration inside than outside. And then there'll be an electrophoretic force, which will make them want to re-enter the cell because positively charged ions are attracted to negative electrodes. And the inside of the cell looks like a negative electrode. And when those two forces, the tendency to diffuse out and the attraction to the electric field back in, are equal to each other, you'll come to a resting voltage, and that's the resting membrane voltage. And it can be minus 58 millivolts in a squid axon. It's about minus 65 millivolts on average in a human neuron. But whatever that resting potential is, you'll reach it and you'll stabilize there. And the only things you've needed to get there are a semi-permeable membrane and a concentration gradient. Well, the concentration gradient came about because of the active transporters, but the active transporters did not directly lead to this resting potential. Once you're at this resting potential, you'll stay there. The active transporters can stay turned off forever, and you'll stay at this resting membrane potential. In fact, you can go in to a neuron, and you can measure the resting membrane potential that you would get for different concentrations of potassium inside to outside of the cell. So for varying concentrations, you would get a different resting membrane potential, and that relationship is logarithmic. So you can plot it on a logarithmic scale, and you can see that if you look at the resting membrane potential as a function of the concentration of potassium outside the cell, you'll get a rising membrane potential. And when you reach this point of 440 millimolar of potassium outside the cell, your concentration outside is the same as it is inside, and your resting membrane potential will be zero. So that resting membrane potential is going to be directly proportional to the concentration of potassium inside to outside of the cell. Now we can take another step, and we can say, all right, so this is what it is for potassium. What is it for sodium? So in sodium, you're going to have exactly the same situation, except that the membrane is not permeable to sodium. But if it was semi-permeable to sodium rather than potassium, then you would have sodium ions from outside of the cell flowing through the membrane into the cell and creating a net voltage where the inside of the cell would be positive with respect to the outside. So you'd have a positive resting membrane voltage. And then you would have a relationship in which changing the concentration of sodium inside the cell would give you a decreasing membrane potential until you reach zero, when the concentration of sodium inside was the same as the concentration of sodium outside. So if you have these two ions, and you have sodium, potassium, more sodium outside than in, more potassium inside than out, and you have this resting membrane voltage with a negative voltage inside with respect to the outside when the membrane is semi-permeable only to potassium, and you would have, hypothetically, a resting membrane voltage where the inside was positive with respect to the outside if the membrane was semi-permeable to sodium rather than potassium, then what would happen if you were to switch your membrane permeability from potassium to sodium and back? If you started with a semi-permeable membrane to potassium, you would have a voltage of negative 65 millivolts. Given the concentrations that you would expect to see in a mammalian neuron, if you switched to becoming semi-permeable to potassium, that voltage would go from minus 65 millivolts up to about plus 20 millivolts. So you would have a depolarizing shift from minus 65 to 20 millivolts. If you then switched back from being semi-permeable to sodium to being semi-permeable to potassium, you would go from 20 millivolts all the way back to minus 65. So initially, you would have this outflow of potassium channels, which would establish your resting membrane potential. Then when you switch permeabilities, the sodium ions would want to flow into the cell for two reasons. One, because the electric field is more negative inside than out, and sodium ions are also positively charged. And two, because they want to diffuse in, there's a higher concentration of sodium outside than in. So they would flow in until the cell became positive on the inside and negative on the outside, and then they would still continue to flow in because of the diffusion. And then they would reach an equilibrium point where the diffusion force into the cell would equal and opposite to the electrophoretic force keeping them out of the cell. And you would reach the resting membrane potential for sodium. So you have a resting membrane potential for each type of ion that the membrane can be semipermeable to. And then if the semipermeability of the membrane turned back to being semipermeable to potassium, potassium ions would flow back out. And when they flow back out, they take their positive charge with them. The outside of the cell becomes more positive than the inside until you go back to the resting membrane potential for potassium of minus 65 millivolts across the membrane. So you can start at minus 65, go up to 20, and back down to minus 65. And that process whereby you can switch the voltage, and all of this is passive, right? There's been no active transport of any kind. All of this is passive, and you've gone from minus 65 to plus 20 back to minus 65. That's how you generate an electrical signal, and that's what we call an action potential. And we'll talk a lot more about that over the coming lectures. But that process is entirely passive. You've generated an electrical signal with an absolutely minimal consumption or requirement of energy. Now, if you do that, and you do that many, 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 many times, you'll find, of course, that over time, or thousands and thousands of action potentials, you've leaked out quite a bit of potassium, restoring the membrane voltage every single time you needed to restore it. And you've absorbed quite a bit of sodium, depolarizing the membrane every time you needed to depolarize. And so that will affect your concentration gradient, and after many, many, many thousands of times, you'll get to a situation in which you will then need those active transporters again. And in fact, they've been working all along. But you'll need those active transporters again to reestablish, or to maintain, rather, the concentration gradient that you began with. So you need them to maintain that steady concentration level. And the more you fire action potentials, the more you'll need them to work to maintain that concentration gradient. But for the neuron that fires very seldom, those active transporters are going to be needed, likewise, very seldom. So what we're going to look at next is, having looked at this and how this phenomenon works and understood it intuitively, is we're going to try to see if we can describe what's going on here using numbers and derive the equations that govern this behavior and that allow us to predict numerically what we would expect to be the resting memory potential for a particular neuron at a particular time. And that's what we will cover in the next lecture. I'll see you then.